absolute pleasure to be on ASX Connect today, and look forward to presenting this on behalf of everyone at NexGen Energy. We are securing the energy transition, and I'll just reference everyone to our forward-looking statements on our website. The world is currently embracing nuclear energy. Even here in Australia, there's a lot of debate around the... Hang on, my apologies. Hold on a second. Just taking care of that. Thank you. Yeah, the world's absolutely embracing the nuclear energy as a foundation of its energy transition. You've seen the European Union designate nuclear energy as clean, green, and safe relative to any baseload form of power. You've seen the US with the Inflation Reduction Act as well put in an enormous number of incentives for the development of nuclear energy. And the US is still the world's largest producer of nuclear energy, approximately 20% of its domestic power grid. And that is expanding. The need for power, full stop, is prevalent on every country in the world, particularly the developing countries. When you consider the Asian continent, less than 5% of the population have power at night, it does really convey just the future demand for energy, full stop. And then on top of that, having a requirement that it's not carbon emitting. The only source of power that can really provide base load energy, so when you go to turn on the lights, you know they are going to be turned on, is nuclear energy. And it's carbon free, and it's actually the lowest cost of all forms of energy once up and running. With respect to NexGen Energy, we are currently developing what will be the world's largest producer of uranium. Approximately 25% of the world's supply when in production, and probably closer to around 50% of the Western world's supply when in production. And that's a really important element when you consider around 45% of the world's current production is from Russian or Russian-influenced countries. 100% of our future production is leveraged to the future uranium market prices. And that's very, very pertinent as well, considering uranium's typically been an industry that have contracted the majority of its production years in advance. So with NexGen, we are heading into production in the latter part of this decade, and we're fully exposed to the future prices of uranium. We are located in the world-class jurisdiction of Saskatchewan, Canada. It's consistently ranked in the top three mining jurisdictions in the world for developing a resources project. And up until 2017, it was also the world's leading producer of uranium from the mines run by Cameco and the French utility Orano. And as a team, since this wonderful discovery back in 2014, the NexGen team's continuously in everything that we've done set new industry standards. And that's from the actual discovery itself, the cost and time efficiency of developing the resource, and then all the environmental programs and design parameters that we've put into the mine will make this one of the most environmentally elite managed mines globally. And then when you throw on top of that, our approach to Indigenous community inclusion into every facet of our operations, we're well recognized for leading the world for a Canadian mining company with respect to that Indigenous inclusion. Just with respect to the rising demand for nuclear energy, it's predicted to go up by 127% by 2030, and then on top of that, 200% by 2040 over current demand levels. And yet supply is really under a lot of pressure. Currently, we have a demand and supply gap of around 60 million pounds per annum. And that is forecast to continue and grow as we go forward. With respect to NexGen's Rook I project, we're really talking about needing five of these projects to come online before 2040 in order to fulfill this gap. And now these projects, we discovered our project back on Valentine's Day in 2014. From discovery through to production, it's going to be a total of 15 years. So the world is behind in terms of the discovery of these projects and the development of these projects, and the consequence is going to be far higher uranium prices as we move forward. Just at a glance, where does our project rank on the world stage in terms of all deposits? Well, if you look at all-in cash costs and size and capital intensity, we are down in the bottom left-hand corner, which is exactly where you want to be. This project is an economic phenom with respect to return on capital and payback period and after-tax NPV. I've highlighted there a range of uranium price assumptions, and I've highlighted $100 a pound. We're currently at $91 a pound. And for those of you who experienced the uranium environment back in 2004 to 2008, we saw prices go from $7 a pound to $136 a pound. Now, $136 in today's terms is about $205 US. And the big difference between today's environment and back in 2004-08 is that the top five mines that were in production back then, when the price went to $136 a pound US, are no longer in production today. So, you know, our forecasts for far higher prices from where we are today is based on financial fact and also taking into account the state of current world production. But at $100 a pound, and as I said, we're currently at 91, this project produces an after-tax IRR of 81.6%. And this is based on a feasibility study, an NI 43-101 feasibility study completed back in February 21. Yes, there has been cost inflation since then, but the overall economics of this project are relatively unchanged. And the after-tax payback, or the after-tax net cash flow every year at about $100 a pound uranium is in the vicinity of $1.6 billion annually. The other aspect with respect to our project, we have a phenomenal project, as I just outlined economically, is that we actually discovered it with only the 21st drill hole on our property. Now, that land package there in the southwestern section of the Athabasca Basin represents around 320,000 hectares. Finding what is the world's best, largest, highest grade deposit in an elite environmental setting with the 21st drill hole, I would suggest that there's clearly a lot more mineralization still to be discovered on our project. We actually had a new discovery 3.5 kilometers east of the Arrow to project only about 8 weeks ago. And it's on an entirely separate system, and something which we're eager to follow up this coming June, well, the summer in North America, but the winter in Australia. And we're very, very excited by it. Just going forward, any discovery with respect to our project, which supplements that feasibility study, really will just be extend the life of the project. We're talking for an initial 24-year mining license. We're in the final stages of receiving the federal approvals to start construction, which would then be followed by production. And we were the first company in over 20 years to receive a provincial environmental approval from the province of Saskatchewan. We're in the final stages federally. We're down to less than 50 aspects that we're closing off, and we'll be resubmitting our responses to those aspects in the coming weeks. To put this all in perspective, We're on path to become a top 10 world mining company at $100 a pound uranium, as I showed you on a few slides prior. We'll be producing net after-tax cash flow of approximately $1.6 billion per annum. Now, to put that in perspective, that would take us to number 9 of all mining companies worldwide, excluding the gold companies and the precious metal companies, of course. And then at $150 a pound, we'll be number 7. Depending on your view of where the prices of uranium is going, we are going into a becoming a top 10 world mining company. And when that's purely from an economic perspective. But when you also then look at the environmental consequence of this, the uranium that the company is going to produce will remove the equivalent of 70 million vehicles of CO2 equivalent off the road annually. That's 70 million vehicles. To give you some comparison, Tesla produced 1.8 million cars in 2023. And they're really just the conduit of electricity. We are actually generating the fuel that will reduce CO2 emissions by the equivalent of 70 million vehicles annually. Or to put that into another perspective, what type of power will that generate? It'll power the equivalent of 46 million homes in the US, a third of all homes in the US. So from an economic perspective, this is an economic phenom in a very sound jurisdiction in Saskatchewan, Canada. It'll produce enormous cash flows annually and will be contributing to actually addressing the world's power need and in a carbon-free manner at the same time. And I see on the presentations a lot of discussion around diversity, et cetera. We're doing this where we're setting we actually in Canada for a Canadian resources company have the highest percentage of female employees right across our organization. With respect to Indigenous community employees at our project site, we have a very bold target of 75%, which in the industry has been recognized that's a very bold target. Well, we're currently tracking at 83%. And so from an economic perspective, an environmental perspective, and then from a social perspective, we are ticking every box, and I would suggest at the top end of those boxes and those lists in terms of a rank relative to other resources companies in the sector. So with that, I might just leave it there and open up to questions from the audience.
Great, Lee. Thank you for that. Great insight. I'd say finding the resource you seem to have found on the 21st drilling was tantamount to finding the needle in the haystack. Well done.
But it certainly was. Look, that was about the function of a 12-year experience in the sector. It was a combination of a lot of people's effort. Clearly, we ran a very sound geological campaign. But were we that good that we found it so early? To your point, Ian, I don't think so. I think there's clearly an enormous amount of potential mineralization in and around our project that we're yet to discover.
Okay. Nuclear energy, uranium, they're all very topical at present. How have you been going with your discussions? As you say, you're the provider of the energy for Tesla. How are you going with those conversations with the likes of Tesla, utilities, and other potential users?
Your utilities there's never been a situation like this in the past where utilities have been so uncovered with respect to their future contracting of uranium. And so we're experiencing it. We've been flooded with requests to sign offtake arrangements for our offtake. And I think that is representative that a large producer in the Russia and Russian-controlled countries, that ability for US utilities, European utilities to continue to procure from those sources is under pressure. And then on top of that, just the actual generation of mined uranium is a tough ask. And so the mine supply worldwide currently is very fragile, and US utilities, European utilities and Asian utilities are recognizing that. And so we're entering into the very beginnings of a real strong contracting cycle. And we've seen that before in 04 to 08, the price went from $7 a pound to 136. We're at the cusp of that again. And projects that are positioned in sound jurisdictions such as Canada, Australia, and the US are certainly going to receive a premium.
You've answered a number of questions along the way there about the impending or potential Russian bans on uranium exports. You've also covered off that rapid run-up in pricing back in 2004. None of those mines were in production, I think you said.
Correct.
Is this all pointing towards reducing supply of product?
Yes, supply is under a lot of pressure, and yet demand is increasing. The consequence is going to be higher prices. The price needs to be a lot higher to incentivize a lot of projects in Canada, Australia, and the US. And the demand for supply from those countries has never been stronger given the political instability of Russia's invasion into the Ukraine.
Question here on your financials relating to the EBITDA. I think actually the question helps me here because it refers to slide 10, where you showed those 5-year comparisons. Just asking what's going on with EBITDA around years 5 and 6. There seems to be some changes there. Is that to do with
that's purely a function under 43.101 reporting requirements. You can only use the measured and indicated resource. Now we have a substantial 80 million pound inferred resource, which will convert into the measured and indicated with higher density drilling. But the graph there shows the first 10 years of production only. And then once that inferred resource converts to measured and indicated with additional drilling, that will then smooth out that production curve. We've also got a number of, like a lot of areas of mineralization under the arrow grade shell that we've intersected mineralization 150 meters away as well, that currently isn't in the resource statement. And so that's why we're permitting for an initial 24-year mine license, and that reflects our perspective of the deposition in and around the Arrow project.
Okay. A question we often get asked when we hear of companies doing business offshore, choosing to list on ASX. Why ASX? Why does that work for you?
Yeah, it's we've experienced very strong demand on the ASX. And so when I founded the company back in 2011, the majority of shareholders were Australian. It's always averaged at around 25-30% whilst being listed on the TSX and the New York Stock Exchange. But we dual listed onto the ASX back in 21 through demand. We're hitting a sweet spot for really ASX investors where we have a project, we're about to develop it in a commodity upcycle, and we're in a very, very strong jurisdiction such as Canada. And so recently, over the last 8 months, some very large ASX institutions that were mentioned earlier by Deborah joined the registry. Really replaced a 20% shareholder in Li Ka-shing out of Asia, who had an average entry of around $2 Canadian, with Australian-based investors averaging around a $10 Canadian entry price into the company. And that has generated far greater demand from other ASX institutions who like our profile in resources and the manner in which we are developing this project to develop a new leading world-class mining company, which I think the space has been a little void of over the last decade or so.
Great note to finish on, Lee. Thank you from the ASX for the little advertisement. Greatly, I'm sure they appreciate that. Great talking with you and hearing your story. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you for having me.